Recorded Books and RB Digital present War and Peace, FDR's Final Odyssey, D-Day to Yalta, 1943 to 1945, by Nigel Hamilton. Narrated by Shaun Grindell. Prologue. In the summer of 1940, following evacuation of British and French troops at Dunkirk, the new British Prime Minister feared an invasion of England by the German Wehrmacht, a prospect that aroused him to some of the greatest oratory in history. "We shall fight on the beaches," Mr. Churchill declared before Parliament. "We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender." It was his greatest speech, and a singular example of leadership of a nation at war. 3 years later, thanks to America's leading contribution to the struggle against Adolf Hitler's Third Reich, the situation was reversed. Hitler was aware the Western Allies were planning an invasion somewhere along the Atlantic Wall, probably on the coast of northwest France, defended by almost 1 million German troops. "If they attack in the West," he warned his generals in December 1943, "this attack will decide the war." It would come in the spring of 1944, at the end of winter weather. The Führer was certain, though he had the feeling, he said, the British didn't have their, shall we say, whole heart in this attack. Hitler was right. Churchill was fearful, and did everything he could as Prime Minister and quasi-commander-in-chief of the forces of the British Empire to postpone the landings, or sabotage the invasion by embarking on foolish enterprises elsewhere. The story of how President Roosevelt held the feet of the British to the D-Day fire is thus a fascinating one, and historic in that Operation Overlord was mounted in the spring of 1944, and, as Hitler had warned, it did decide the war. 75 years after the triumphant Allied landings in Normandy, it seems a shame, therefore, that FDR's role as Commander-in-Chief should largely have been forgotten. For, more than any other single individual, it was Franklin Delano Roosevelt, commanding the armed forces of the United States, who made D-Day happen. Moreover, who made the fateful decision, in person, in North Africa, over who was to lead the historic landings. A kind reviewer, Evan Thomas, called The Mantle of Command the first volume of my FDR at War trilogy, the memoir Roosevelt didn't get to write. While the trilogy is, of course, a biography rather than a memoir, Thomas's point was that, unlike Winston Churchill, who went on to write his war memoirs in 6 grand volumes, FDR did not live to do so. Dying of a cerebral hemorrhage 2 weeks before Hitler committed suicide, Roosevelt was unable to give his own account of the trials and tribulations he'd faced as US Commander-in-Chief since Pearl Harbor, almost 3.5 years earlier. Like Winston Churchill, Franklin Roosevelt had, however, begun to assemble the necessary papers he would need to write his own war story, papers his secretaries had filed in the Oval Office, as well as the secret communications kept under strict security in the White House map room. And those, too, that he'd amassed at the presidential library he'd had built beside his home at Hyde Park, and which he proposed to donate to the nation. 4 months after the D-Day landings, in October 1944, he had even begun to use a young Harvard graduate, Lieutenant George Elsey, the officer in charge of the map room team staff, to help him prepare the library to safely house his secret papers from the Oval Office. As Elsey later recalled, it was remotely possible that Roosevelt might lose the 1944 presidential election to Thomas Dewey. He considered it a possibility, and he wanted to know what should be done at the library to ensure the safety of his wartime records and papers, which would automatically go with him to Hyde Park. What should be done to protect them, since in terms of the top secret stuff, the library was not built with that in mind. So he took me up there, to the library, to make recommendations. Elsey was later told by the president's naval aide, Admiral Wilson Brown, that there was a reason Elsey had been recommended for the job, that Lieutenant Elzey, with his background, would be very, very valuable and helpful in doing FDR's memoirs. In retrospect, Elzey, who had just prepared his own eyewitness account of the D-Day landings and several long reports for the president on US allies such as China, realized part of the reason why Roosevelt spent a good deal of time with me, talking with me, I think, was that he was just getting better acquainted, sizing me up for the job of literary assistant. At the same time, Winston Churchill, too, was contemplating the removal from 10 Downing Street of all the wartime papers he would need to document his leadership in the course of the war, a task in which he would employ a bevy of assistants, military subordinates, and the secretary to his wartime cabinet, a group later known as the Syndicate, to help him research and draft his account. Thus when, at the military conference held in Quebec in September 1944, the Canadian Prime Minister had said he hoped Mr. Churchill would, after war's end, recall the saga from his special vantage point as British quasi-commander-in-chief, Churchill had replied that all of this was practically in his papers already, except to give it a certain turn, assuring Mackenzie King that, in his narrative, he would, in due course, be completely frank, omitting nothing. Had Roosevelt survived and published his own account, he will write, his cousin Daisy Suckley had noted in September 1944, and can make a lot of money that way. The world would have been treated to an interesting post-war literary duel, for FDR's account would have differed markedly from that of Sir Winston, as Churchill became in 1953. The highlight of the tourney would undoubtedly have been their competing accounts of D-Day, its inception, the long battle between the two great leaders over its mounting, and its ultimately decisive consequences for the successful prosecution of the war against Hitler. That literary duel, of course, did not take place. It was the president who died prematurely at 63, while the aging former prime minister, forced from high office at 70 in the 1945 British general election, devoted himself in his multi-volume memoirs to a magisterial, if also self-lauding account of how he, rather than Roosevelt, had directed and won World War II. Given that Sir Winston, whom I deeply admired, and with whom as a college student I proudly stayed for a week at Chartwell, his home in Kent before he died, won the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1953 on the basis of his sextet, and was able to make a lot of money publishing it, I do not think it unfair to his memory, 65 years later, to correct the record regarding his version, and as a historian and biographer, to give my own account of the war's military prosecution from President Roosevelt's perspective as US Commander-in-Chief. War and Peace, FDR's final odyssey, D-Day to Yalta, 1944-1945, thus commences with the President's voyage abroad to save D-Day, averting Churchill's last-ditch efforts to delay and sabotage the landings. Following that triumphantly successful trip to Tehran, the American Odysseus, a pseudonym FDR had once used at school at Groton, returned to the United States in the pink, D-Day finally and irrevocably set to be mounted in the spring of 1944, under an American general he had personally chosen on the spot. The invasion, codenamed Overlord, would be backed, Stalin had promised, by a major Russian offensive on the Eastern Front, thus making it impossible for Hitler to reinforce his Wehrmacht armies along the Atlantic Wall. It was the highest point of FDR's career as US Commander-in-Chief in World War II. The Normandy landings, beginning on June 6, 1944, would more than fulfill the President's hopes and his historic D-Day prayer as broadcast to the nation. General Eisenhower's success disproved all Churchill's fears and earlier warnings of disaster. The Allied invasion became, as Hitler had predicted, the deciding battle of the war. Tragically, however, the man who had been ultimately responsible for the Allies' war-winning strategy was unable to take full credit for it. The US Commander-in-Chief had fallen gravely ill with flu on his return from the Middle East, and he never got better. A reality his White House doctor, his press secretary, and his staff did their best to hide from snooping reporters and cameramen. For all that he might dream, following the greatest amphibious invasion in history, of setting foot on the shores of liberated Normandy, as his US chiefs of staff were able to do, it was not to be. Instead, he grew more and more sick with heart disease, more seriously ill, in fact, than any but his closest confidants knew. As Lieutenant Elsie later recalled, the president's health simply plummeted. He lay in bed, unable to focus or to take an interest, often just too ill to bother. This was obviously before D-Day and before the fourth election, but it had to be kept from the public lest it affect war morale. The president never recovered, though he did miraculously survive to see at least that the war would be won, and how. As a result, though, his last year as commander-in-chief was the very opposite of the manner in which he had led the Allies since Pearl Harbor. Sadly, many historians, too many, have judged Franklin Roosevelt's military role in World War II on the basis of his final year in the Oval Office, thus entirely misconstruing his singular, overarching contribution to victory over the Third Reich and the Empire of Japan. My aim in War and Peace, FDR's final odyssey, as the culmination of my FDR at War trilogy, therefore, has been not only to chart with flesh clarity how dire was his affliction, but how it exactly affected his decisions and once masterly performance as Commander-in-Chief of the Western Allies in World War II after Pearl Harbor. It was a record that Winston Churchill, who had been a great national leader but a deeply flawed Commander-in-Chief of the British Empire forces, was only too happy to take from him in literary retrospect. From triumph to personal tragedy is thus the theme undergirding this volume, for the fact is, from being the victorious captain of the Allied vessel in the momentous struggle against Germany, symbolized in the great D-Day landings, the president became thereafter a virtual passenger, with major ramifications not only on the prosecution of the war, but the post-war. That the president lived long enough to see the approach of unconditional Nazi surrender was, at least, a consolation to those intimates who knew Roosevelt best, and who had seen him at his best, as was the sight of him preparing to inaugurate his great contribution to post-war peace, the United Nations. Moreover, the fact, too, that he had been able, at least, to die deeply contented in his personal life, despite his cascading ill health. I hope readers of these three volumes will feel the same in coming to the end of this trilogy, 75 years after the triumph of his greatest military achievement, D-Day. Book 1. Part 1. Going to See Stalin. Chapter 1. A Trip to the Mediterranean. The weather off Argentia, Newfoundland, in the fall of 1903, was boisterous, Captain John McRae later remembered, recalling his command of the US Navy's most powerful new battleship, the USS Iowa. The huge battle wagon was alternately resting at anchor in the northern Atlantic and carrying out ocean-going exercises for his assigned role, guarding US convoy routes to and from the war in Europe and Russia. Launched as the first of its class in January that year, and drawing some 40 feet in depth, the monster vessel had hit a submerged rock in July while entering Casco Bay, Maine, at low tide. It had been only its second shakedown cruise, and a 50-foot gash had been torn in its hull, requiring weeks of repair. Not a good omen. McRae, as the ship's captain, had been reprimanded but not dismissed. He had, after all, been naval aide to the president and commander-in-chief until taking command of the huge vessel, and the gash was swiftly repaired. In October 1943, the Iowa had finally assumed its active role in North Atlantic duties. Manned by more than 2,500 sailors and marines, weighing 55,000 tons when fully loaded, the vessel could make more than 32 knots, and boasted 16-inch guns that could hit targets 20 miles distant. Among the crew, there was hopes of an imminent naval engagement, perhaps even a sea duel with the vessel's equivalent, the Bismarck-class battleship and biggest warship of Hitler's Third Reich, the Tirpitz. Such a sea battle was not improbable. Armed with 8 15-inch guns, The Tirpitz had constantly threatened US and British convoys to Murmansk in aid of the Russian war effort and menaced the North Atlantic. In fact, the Tirpitz had only weeks before slipped its own moorings on the coast of Norway and made a daring Viking-like raid. Leading a German armada on September 8, 1943, the battleship had carried out an amphibious operation, executed with total surprise. Citronella, as it was codenamed, an attack from the sea that completely destroyed the Allied weather station at Spitsbergen and a refueling base there, and captured many of its defenders. In bright sunshine and an unusually gentle wind, the USS Iowa had just weighed anchor, therefore, to undertake further exercises out at sea, when the executive officer brought Captain McCrae a message marked secret. It was from Admiral Ernest J. King, Commander-in-Chief, U.S. Fleet. The Iowa was ordered not to steam toward Norway and possible action, but directly south, back to United States waters. Captain McCrae had not the faintest idea what was afoot or afloat. On McCrae's arrival at Hampton Roads Naval Base in Virginia, Admiral Royal Ingersoll, commander of the U.S. Atlantic Fleet, greeted him tartly. "I suppose you know why you are here." McCrae shook his head. "You are going to take the President and the Joint Chiefs of Staff in Iowa to the Mediterranean." "The entire American High Command? To the Mediterranean?" Captain McCrae took a deep breath. He had, to his credit, considerable experience in handling VIPs. As naval aide to the President, he'd even accompanied Mr. Roosevelt on the President's historic seaplane journey to North Africa earlier that very year. There, at Casablanca, on the shores of Morocco, the military strategy of the Western Allies had been laid down by the President as U.S. Commander-in-Chief, overruling the advice of his Chiefs of Staff. American forces, he had instructed, would first learn how to defeat the Wehrmacht in battle in the Mediterranean, and only then launch a cross-channel attack, probably in the spring of 1944, aimed at Berlin. By October 1943, the year of live-action learning was now almost over. More than a quarter of a million Axis troops had surrendered to General Eisenhower in May 1943, and by July, Allied troops were ashore in strength on the island of Sicily, stepping stone to southern Europe. As Italian troops capitulated or ran away, Wehrmacht units were unable to stem the Allied tide of advance toward Palermo and Reggio, barely 3 miles from the Italian mainland. The Italian leader, Benito Mussolini, had thereupon been toppled as the fascist dictator of Italy by his own colleagues. Having successfully deposed him, the new Italian government under Marshal Badoglio had surrendered unconditionally. The war Hitler had declared on America on December 11, 1941, was thus moving toward its climax. What exactly the President had in mind in crossing the Atlantic for a second time that year was unknown to Captain McCrae, as it was to everyone else. But to find out more about the Iowa's role in the President's latest mission, McCrae was ordered to go to the Navy Department in Washington, D.C., and report to Admiral King in person tomorrow morning. Thus began secret preparations for the Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces of the United States to meet, for the first time, the dictator and Commander-in-Chief of the Soviet armies, Joseph Stalin. Chapter 2. The meeting is on. All year, President Roosevelt had pressed Stalin for a meeting, even sending the former ambassador to the Soviet Union, Joseph E. Davies, to Moscow to negotiate a possible rendezvous. Stalin had, several times, indicated his willingness to parley. In the end, he had always backed out, claiming his responsibilities as commander-in-chief of all Soviet forces in action against the Wehrmacht were too demanding, and that the bitter battles on the Eastern Front simply precluded him from leaving Russia. The President had not believed him. Stalin was known to have visited the battlefront only a single time, and only for a day, but it persevered. Hitler's massive invasion of the Soviet Union in 1941 had failed to reach Moscow, and though Wehrmacht troops had neared the Urals in the summer of 1942, that offensive too had come to grief. Stalingrad, in February 1943, had marked the end of German advances on the Eastern Front, with Hitler calling off his final massed armoured offensive at Kursk in the summer of 1943, when hearing that the Western Allies were ashore in Sicily, threatening to bring down the Pact of Steel, and forcing Hitler to divert armoured divisions to Italy, not Russia. The Soviet Union, facing two-thirds of the German army and beginning to defeat the Wehrmacht decisively in battle, would be a major player in the post-war world, the president was well aware. Finding a modus vivendi with Russia would be in America's best interests. It would also be in the interests of the post-war world, too, if a better security system than was set up after World War I could be devised and agreed. Neither Russia nor the United States had been a member of the League of Nations, which Hitler had effectively neutered when announcing Germany's withdrawal in 1933. This time, however, the United States and the Soviet Union could together take a leadership role in guaranteeing post-war peace. Whether the Soviets would agree to work with the United States and other capitalist nations in the aftermath of the Second World War was another matter. Despite Stalin's radical efforts to industrialize the Soviet Union and mechanize Soviet agriculture, the USSR remained a largely agrarian society, its people ruled by communist dogma, dread of the secret police, fear of forcible resettlement or execution, and paranoia regarding foreign countries. Such paranoia was not only of Stalin's making, however. Hitler's Barbarossa invasion of June 22, 1941, fielding 4 million men drawn from Germany and many other European countries, Austria, Italy, Romania, Hungary, Slovakia, Croatia, Bulgaria, France, and Finland, had resulted in more than 3.5 million casualties by the end of that first year alone. The failure of the United States and Britain to mount a second front in 1942, or the year after that, had only increased Russian xenophobia and suspicion. Distrust of those nations bordering the Soviet Union that had aided Hitler in Barbarossa would probably affect relations with Russia for a generation or more, former Ambassador Davies had reported to the president on his return from his personal mission to Moscow on behalf of the president in June 1943. Distrust was one thing. Need, however, was another. Aware the Soviet Union could not continue the war without US Lend-Lease, American exports that were currently supplying more than 10% of Russia's war needs, Stalin had closed down the Comintern, the communist ideological arm of the Soviet Union. In a further, somewhat dubious demonstration of commitment to the principles of President Roosevelt's Four Freedoms and the Atlantic Charter, the Soviet dictator had even opened Russian churches in the summer of 1943. But Lend-Lease alone would not be enough to defeat Hitler's legions. Facing no fewer than 260 Axis divisions on the Eastern Front, the majority of them German, the Soviets would never be able to defeat the Third Reich without a second front in the West, which would force Hitler to fight major campaigns front and back. Stalin had therefore every interest in Allied military strategy being concerted, which a meeting with President Roosevelt might achieve. At the same time, there must be other reasons why it seemed advisable for Stalin not to meet with the president, Mr. Roosevelt had mused when discussing the conundrum with his advisers and the people around him. Perhaps his Russian counterpart suffered an inferiority complex, the president had suggested, when talking to his cousin Daisy Suckley. And the marshal was reported to be deathly afraid of assassination, a fear reflected in his unwillingness to leave the Kremlin. Given his ruthless dictatorship of the USSR since Lenin's death, this was certainly wise. At any rate, whatever the underlying rationale, it had left the coalition of allies with a sort of vacuum at the very top, in terms of combined military and political strategy, Stalin constantly agreeing to meet and then backing off, offering to send representatives instead. Finally, in October 1943, Stalin had agreed to a two-week-long international conference of foreign ministers in Moscow. This had produced surprisingly positive results, including provisional agreements between US, Soviet and British diplomats, insisting on flying via Africa to Moscow. Despite his ill health, Mr. Cordell Hull, the US Secretary of State, was even able to get quasi-formal Russian consent to the establishment of an eventual United Nations organization, as well as a private indication from Stalin that the Soviets would join the United States war against Japan once Hitler surrendered. Why, in this case, was it actually necessary for Stalin to leave the security of Moscow for a personal meeting with the President of the United States? Why did the President still place so much store by a personal meeting? Why was the President pressing for him to leave Moscow? Historians later tended to see the summit in Tehran, a venue which was ultimately agreed upon only at the last moment, 3 weeks in advance, as the final compromise in a game of statesmanship, or brinkmanship, the location a matter of competing national honour or pride. To a large extent, this was true. In Russian eyes, the US Secretary of State had, after all, flown all the way to Moscow. Why not, Soviet officials had calculated, the President? Behind the competing arguments over the venue for this first meeting of the two world leaders, however, there was another reason that would largely elude historians, and certainly elude the Prime Minister of Britain, the third wheel in the proposed conference at the time. It did not elude Stalin, though. Indeed was, in the end, the reason the Russian Premier overcame his reluctance to leave the Soviet Union, or even Moscow, the matter of D-Day, as the second front landings became known. For without a second front, the war could not be won. The Marshal, to be sure, hated the idea of leaving the motherland, where he was secure as an absolute dictator. He was also afraid of flying. But if the British were plotting to back out of D-Day, as he'd been given reason to believe, then he had better meet with his two fellow warlords in the struggle to defeat the Third Reich. The Russian Premier had thus decided he would go meet the President at a halfway house. The capital of Iran, a neutral country across the Caspian Sea, was as far as he would countenance, however. It was currently under Russian and British occupation. It was also a vast American military supply entrepot. In fact, the primary conduit for US land lease supplies by sea and rail to the Soviet Union. The three US, Russian, and British legations or embassies in Tehran, then, could provide an ideal location for the ultimate high-level coalition military conference held to decide the Allies' military and political strategy in 1944, in the midst of the most violent war in military history. The President had accepted Stalin's reasoning. Churchill had reluctantly agreed to the location too. As Prime Minister of America's closest military ally, he'd insisted, however, that he first meet with President Roosevelt in North Africa or somewhere in the Mediterranean. There, before the Tehran summit, he hoped to dissuade the President from following the current plan, agreed at Quebec in August 1943, for the Allied D-Day invasion to be mounted in the spring of 1944. Instead, Churchill wanted the United States to exploit his latest brainwave, an alternative Mediterranean strategy. Thus was the stage set for one of the most consequential showdowns in military history, with the President the only man powerful enough to stop Churchill from wrecking Overlord, the agreed plan to defeat Nazi Germany. Chapter 3. Maximum Secrecy. For days, ship's carpenters labored on the Iowa as they prepared the huge vessel for its top secret mission. The crew were given 3 days' leave. In the nation's capital, McRae paid a visit to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue and saw his old boss at the White House. "I suppose, Ernie, Admiral King has told you about the coming trip?" the President asked McRae as they sat together in the Oval Office. Admiral King had, to McRae's memorable discomfort. At the Navy Department on the Mall, the Navy's still refusing to join the Army in the recently completed Pentagon building. The Iowa's captain had innocently remarked that, after delivering the President to the war zone, the battleship would presumably leave North Africa in order to return to combat duties. There was a moment of silence, ominous silence, McCrae remembered. Reputed to shave with a blowtorch, the balding, bullet-headed commander-in-chief of the US Navy was strictly business, a man of few words. Each enunciated with precision, McCrae later recalled in admiration. There was never any doubt as to what he said or what he wanted. I can't imagine anyone ever slapping him on the back by way of greeting. He was austere, he was ramrod straight, and carried himself with dignity. In my book, he was everything a naval officer should have been. McCrae lauded the admiral's memory, discreetly passing over King's well-known penchant for other men's wives. What counted, in McCrae's view, had been the admiral's complete and unequivocal loyalty to the commander-in-chief of the armed forces of the United States, the president. I shall not subject the President to a westward December crossing of the Atlantic in a heavy cruiser, King had snapped, which had been the plan McCrae had been informed of earlier. Iowa will remain available for that duty, King ordered, speaking with a firmness and coldness that made McCrae regret he'd opened his mouth. McCrae would thus transport the President to North Africa and collect him after he was done. At the White House, the President seemed in fine fettle, McCrae later recalled. He looked to be in good health. He had a great zest for living, which was contagious, and seemed full of beans. I am looking forward to it greatly, Mr. Roosevelt remarked, assuring McCrae that in his view there was nothing so wonderful as a sea voyage by way of relaxation. A sea voyage in the midst of a world war. In spite of a resurgence of German U-boat attacks on Allied shipping, McCrae was not so sure, but said nothing. As to the departure date, Admiral King had said the President wished first to attend the annual ceremonies of the unknown soldier at Arlington Cemetery on Armistice Day, November 11, 1943. A must. Immediately afterwards, however, he would take his special armored train, the Ferdinand Magellan, to Newport News, and stay on it overnight, in order to board the Iowa early the next morning, November 12. Admiral King would travel with the President, as would the other chiefs of staff. Admiral William D. Leahy, the President's White House Chief of Staff, as well as Chairman of the U.S. Joint Chiefs of Staff. General George C. Marshall, Chief of Staff of the U.S. Army, and General Henry H. Arnold, Chief of Staff of the U.S. Army Air Forces. Also General Brehan Somerville, Chief of U.S. Army Service Forces, plus dozens of the Chief's staffs. McCrae had taken a deep breath. The entire High Command of the United States military to an active theater of war, on one ship. Secrecy would thus be of paramount importance. In Hampton Roads, the USS Iowa was repainted Atlantic grey. It was also provisioned for the transatlantic journey. Unusual features were added too. On Sunday afternoon, November 7, a derrick lighter came alongside and hoisted two very heavy steel battleship grey elevators aboard. These were welded at once to the Iowa's starboard main and superstructure decks, almost amidships. One elevator rose from the main to the first superstructure deck, and its companion was placed inboard, terminating at the flag and signal bridge level. As one of the officers remarked, anyone with half an eye can guess the nature of our next assignment. Finally, on November 11, 1943, the Iowa, having discharged most of its fuel and drawing significantly less water, anchored a few miles up the Potomac River, for McCrae had persuaded Admiral King and the President to repeat the Potomac ruse of 1941. On that occasion, still in peacetime, the President had pretended to go out fishing on his presidential yacht in order to shake off journalists. Once at sea, he'd secretly transferred to a warship to meet with Churchill at Argentia, where he'd gotten Churchill to sign on to the Atlantic Charter. The Iowa positioned off Cherry Point, Virginia. Captain McCrae now ordered the entire ship's crew to assemble on the main aft deck and explained what, for the most part, they had intuited. That they'd been selected by the President and our Commander-in-Chief to participate in an important mission. That evening, Admiral King's 258-foot yacht and flagship, the USS Dauntless, formerly the privately owned yacht Delphine, came alongside, bearing the US Chiefs of Staff and their staffs, though not the US Commander-in-Chief or Admiral Leahy. One by one, the officers were taken to their cabins, and aboard the great battleship, they spent the night at anchor. Roosevelt, aboard the 168-foot USS Potomac, meantime, sailed all night from the Washington Navy Yard, with no prying journalists following. He'd received Stalin's confirmation, cabled on November 10. The meeting in Tehran was on. It was a grey morning, and cold at Cherry Point, the Iowa ship's chronicler afterwards recorded. The river looked distinctly uninviting. A chill wind whipped the surface of the Potomac into fluttering whitecaps. At 9:15, the tiny white presidential yacht, Potomac, hove into distant view. As she drew near the Iowa's starboard side, the seal of the chief executive could be observed on the bridge. A gangway was rigged between the Iowa's side and the Potomac's main decks aft. The President of the United States boarded the Iowa at 9:16 to be welcomed by Captain McRae. Mr. Roosevelt had requested that honors be dispensed with. He wore a soft brown hat and his famed sea cape over a tan sharkskin suit. Sitting in his wheelchair, the president was then taken to the captain's quarters, on the starboard side, forward, or the first superstructure deck. The president was not alone. This time he was accompanied by both his military aides, Major General Edwin Parr Watson and Naval Aide Rear Admiral Wilson Brown, also his chief of staff, Admiral William Leahy. His dedicated White House counselor, Mary Hopkins, boarded too, and Admiral Ross McIntyre, the president's personal physician. They were all present, with the president occupying the captain's quarters and McRae moving to his seagoing cabin in the conning tower above. McRae was fully aware of his responsibility. On the shoulders of the president and his senior military subordinates rested the strategy for the ultimate prosecution of the war in Europe, the endgame. In this sense, the journey promised to be more historic even than the President's Atlantic Charter meeting in 1941, or his flight to Casablanca in January 1943. Stringent secrecy remained McRae's major concern, but there were other worries also. Admiral McIntyre was not keen on the onward plane journeys that would necessarily follow, perhaps at high altitudes, once the ship reached North Africa, a concern because of the president's heart. Assuming the Iowa even got there, safety was hardly guaranteed. Neither of the president's military aides had been eager for Mr. Roosevelt to travel by sea, since a transatlantic voyage would be subject to U-boat interception. Once in North Africa, air travel would, moreover, be subject to Luftwaffe attack. The latter was no idle threat either. American pilots had, after all, ambushed and shot down the commander-in-chief of the Japanese Navy in the Pacific, Admiral Yamamoto, 400 miles behind Japanese front lines early in April that very year, killing him. The president's proposed flight route would be from Iran to Cairo, along the shores of North Africa. From there he would fly to southern Iran, and from there the plan was to travel north to Tehran, either by air or by train. Those of us who had to do with the planning for this expedition were very conscious that the president was running grave personal risk, Admiral Brown later wrote candidly, because we believed that if the enemy could learn of his whereabouts, they would spare no effort to attack by air, submarine, or assassin. Even with the strictest censorship, rumors of his activities and whereabouts, he explained, were almost certain to leak out. By the early summer of 1943, the U-boat menace had been all but extinguished, thanks to US and British air patrols across the Atlantic. But thanks to new German snorkels, which permitted U-boats to remain submerged and avoid Allied air reconnaissance, the Atlantic battle had now resurged with wolf pack vengeance. The undersea menace was not all. Above the waves, a new destructive glider bomb had been put into combat, raising havoc against Allied shipping in the Mediterranean. Havoc was no exaggeration. Often forgotten after the war, the new German guided missile, the Fritz X-bomb, had been employed for the first time against Allied naval forces during the US invasion of Italy in September 1943, the latest example of German engineering. It was the world's first effective remote-controlled combat missile, able to penetrate battleships and heavy cruisers. The powerful projectile was steered by Funkgerät, or radio remote control, operated by a technician aboard a mother plane at 18,000 feet behind the flying bomb, aiming it directly toward the target. During the Salerno landings on September 9, two Fritz X bombs had sunk the Italian battleship Roma as it attempted to abscond and join the Allies, killing the majority of its 1,850-man crew in the process. Another Fritz X had disabled Roma's sister battleship, Italia. Hits were also scored on the light cruiser USS Savannah, killing 200 American soldiers off Salerno, forcing the cruiser out of action and requiring it to return to the United States for 12 months. The USS Philadelphia, on which the president had cruised in 1938, was narrowly missed by a Fritz X the same day, September 11. It was fortunate in being only lightly damaged, but HMS Uganda, a British light cruiser, was not so lucky on September 13. It received a direct hit by a Fritz X that penetrated through to its keel, a fate that befell HMS Warspite too, a British battleship that was crippled on September 16, along with a number of Allied supply vessels. New low-level Henschel HS-293 guided missiles, also steered from accompanying Luftwaffe mother planes, were sinking yet more Allied naval vessels in the Mediterranean. With one hit on the USS Iowa, once it entered Mediterranean waters through the Gibraltar Straits, the Germans could, theoretically, destroy the entire US High Command. For his part, Mr. Roosevelt had refused to listen to such fears. His hands were a trifle shaky. His feet swelled when he was tired, and he was keyed up and couldn't relax, his cousin and loyal companion Daisy Suckley noted in her diary several days before the president's departure. But nothing would stop him now that Stalin had agreed, definitely, to meet in Iran. There was, after all, simply too much at stake. Chapter 4. Setting sail. Daisy was yet another person who hated the idea of a second presidential trip abroad that year. Not only was it dangerous for the partially paralyzed president to travel to an active theater of war, in terms of possible enemy interception, but a flight to Tehran, which was as far as Stalin would agree to travel, involved an ascent over the mountains of up to 15,000 feet, traversing the Zagros range, and inevitably taxing the president's suspect heart, as she'd noted in her diary on October 30, 1943. Roosevelt's hands may have developed a noticeable tremor, but mentally the president seemed full of ginger and anticipation, pulling down a map of Africa and the Bible lands of the Middle East in his White House study and showing Daisy his itinerary for the long trip from Iran and Algeria to Cairo and Egypt by air, then again by air over Palestine and Iraq, landing in Iran to take the train. He seemed excited at the thought of being far from Washington, with its endless political backbiting and the further loss of Democratic congressional seats suffered in last year's November elections. Also a possible union coal strike to contend with. His adoring cousin had therefore felt torn, the more so since Eleanor, the president's loyal but exceedingly busy spouse, seemed to pay too little attention, in Daisy's opinion, to his precarious health. Sitting together, they talked about domestic matters, both private and public. Eleanor had become, in a sense, his eyes and ears with respect to national issues, given her many travels across the country. A pleader of social, economic, and political causes, she would often spend an hour or more making her case for action late at night, when she said goodnight to him. Daisy said nothing, but was concerned. "He's just too tired, too often. I can't help worrying about him," she confided to her diary. On November 8, for example, He'd had some 23 appointments in the Oval Office, even before being subjected to Eleanor's near-midnight entreaties. Worry or no worry over safety, the long trip to Tehran was now beginning. The USS Potomac having cast off, the President greeted his Joint Chiefs of Staff and his White House staff in his comfortably large Iowa cabin. Whether the fishing trip ruse would really work was anybody's guess, but once the battleship weighed anchor, no one would know where they were. Admiral Leahy reflected, "Every effort has been made to prevent the leak of any information in regard to the expedition," he noted in his diary that evening. "We will have no communication whatever with the shore, and it is hoped that the President, with his staff, can succeed in reaching the port of Oran in Africa before the enemy learns of his whereabouts and his intentions." The Iowa thus duly departed from Cherry Point the morning of November 12, 1943. Arriving at Hampton Roads in the evening, it then anchored once more in darkness, to be refueled in deeper water by two tankers at Berth B, since the ship had pumped out much of its oil in order to have the shallower draft necessary for a Cherry Point rendezvous. Once the tanks were refilled, the commander-in-chief asked the ship's captain to wait a few more hours. "You know, John," he said to McCrae, "today is Friday. We are about to start on an important mission. Before it is over, many important decisions must be made. I am sailor enough to share the sailor's superstition that Friday is an unlucky day. Do you suppose you could delay getting underway until Saturday? This, of course, without interrupting your plans too much." Marvelling at the Commander-in-Chief's attention to nautical lore, McCrae, therefore, ordered the battleship to remain anchored, but with its chains shortened. Its course was designed to take them toward Bermuda, then the Azores, then to continue across the remaining waters of the Atlantic, until they reached the narrow Straits of Gibraltar, escorted by successive groups of three destroyers, which carried less fuel, watching for U-boats. Assuming all went well, the last American destroyer squadron approaching North Africa would be beefed up with additional British destroyers, as well as a US aircraft carrier or flat top. In order to maintain absolute secrecy regarding the Iowa's passengers, however, and the destination of the voyage, no information had been given even to the commander of the first destroyer escort, other than the charge to protect the Iowa, and then be ready for distant service. Copious amounts of presidential china and silverware had been brought along for use on the ship, to be unloaded and taken by air with the presidential party once the passengers were transferred to land. Liquor was also aboard, the president skirting the prohibition against alcohol on US naval vessels by claiming that, as US commander-in-chief, he could do as he wished. This meant he could have his ritual martini cocktail hour at the end of the day. He'd also arranged with Captain McCrae that he would have exclusive use of the outdoor first superstructure deck, port and starboard, where he would spend every afternoon thinking, reading or napping, or making notes in the new journal Daisy had given him for this trip, one of the few diary records Roosevelt would keep during the war. As the Iowa thus made its way down the Hampton Roads Channel toward the ocean on November 13, the huge warship piloted by an experienced Coast Guard Lieutenant Commander, the President inked his first entry in his tall, forward-tilting, emphatic script, with its characteristically high crossed T's and bold capitals. "This will be another Odyssey," Franklin Delano Roosevelt penned, thinking of Homer's Odysseus the Cunning, or Ulysses as the Romans called him. The long journey would take much further afield and afloat than the hardy Trojan whose name I used to take at Groton when I was competing for school prizes, but it will be filled with surprises, he predicted, aware that any number of things could go wrong. The prospect of a week's leisure at sea certainly buoyed the president, however. Enough motion picture films for a show every night had been brought with them, according to the signals lieutenant tasked with drawing up a checklist, plus a well-stocked library of pocket guides, whodunits, and other reading matter. "I'm safely on my way," the president wrote Daisy in a last letter he left for her at Hampton Roads. "UJ, Uncle Joe, i.e. Stalin, wired he will meet us, so you know all," he confided. thanking her for her gift of a special chemically-induced hot water maker for the high-altitude flight to Tehran, which now looked like a better option than the train. It's a lovely day, but cold. I am being showered with every security and every comfort, and I am optimistic about results. I much wonder when the cat will be out of the bag. Time would tell. He turned in sometime after 10 p.m. They were off. Chapter 5. Sheer Madness. Thanks to lax British censorship in Cairo, the world was to find out all too soon where the leaders of the Western world were meeting. In the meantime, however, the president attempted to assure his staff and advisers that all would be well. As he noted in his diary, "We are offshore, escorted by destroyers and planes. Very luxurious in the Iowa, which with her sister ship, the NJ, USS New Jersey, are the largest battleships in the world. Captain McRae is very proud of the Iowa, with its population of 2,700 officers and men." He added, "I have his cabin. In my mess are Admirals Leahy, W. Brown, McIntyre, General Watson, and Harry Hopkins. The joint staffs are one deck up. Generals Marshall, Arnold, Somerville, and Admiral King. And below are 100 members of the planning staff." In short, he was proud to be travelling as US Commander-in-Chief, taking with him his entire high command to the current theatre of battle, the Mediterranean, and absolutely determined that the next battlefield would be, as formally agreed at Quebec, northern France, in the spring of 1944. The president has been very straight lately, and has stood up to Churchill better than at any time heretofore, the elderly war secretary had recorded after seeing the president on November 4, though Henry L. Stimson still distrusted the British Prime Minister. With all his lip service, Churchill is against the Channel operation, and instead is determined to push forward new diversions into the Balkans, Turkey, and possibly other places, which will inevitably drain off ships and men from the final decisive conflict which we are trying to ensure in France. Stimson was right to be suspicious of Churchill, who had been acting strangely in recent weeks, according to reports coming back to Washington, as well as long, plaintive cables the Prime Minister had been sending the President. The initial cause of Churchill's distress had been the disasters that had befallen his unilateral British attempts to seize the Aegean islands of Rhodes, Kos, Samos, and Leros, near Turkey, in tandem with the Allied landings on the southern coasts of Italy in September. The Aegean landings were fatally misconceived and execrably executed, launched exclusively by British Empire forces from the Middle East, without US help or even knowledge. Instead of accepting their embarrassing defeat by the Wehrmacht as part of the fortunes of war, however, the Prime Minister had, in mid-October 1943, begun a new plot to delay, and if possible sabotage Overlord, in favour of redoubling efforts in the Mediterranean and the Aegean. Churchill had always been a meddler, as one of his senior battlefield generals put it, unable to stop himself from trying to influence and, if possible, direct operations in the field. Had the Prime Minister been a great military commander, this might have made sense. Ever since his tragicomedy when attempting to command the defence of Antwerp in 1914 and masterminding the assault on Gallipoli in 1915, his attempts at generalship had proven fatal for the ill-prepared troops committed by him to combat. His opportunism demonstrated the force of his vivid imagination and sheer courage. It had rarely, if ever, been based on a realistic appreciation of what he could expect his own soldiers to accomplish against a tough and ruthless enemy. This flaw, sadly, was now leading him to the most consequential mistake of his long life, in terms of military strategy and Allied unity. His third and most egregious attempt to subvert the D-Day invasion, and instead reinforce failure in the Mediterranean. Having assembled his chiefs of staff in London, the Prime Minister had on the evening of October 19 asked them not to pursue their work on plans for the Overlord invasion, but instead to focus all their attention on covert operational plans to invade the Balkans. "Pray let this inquiry be conducted in a most secret manner," he'd instructed them, and on the assumptions, the commitments into which we have already entered, at Quebec with the Americans, particularly as regards Overlord, could be modified by agreement to meet the exigencies of a changing situation. By secret, he meant without American knowledge. By modified, he meant postponement, if possible, to 1945. By agreement, he meant using legerdemain with the president, whom he would try to see on his own in Cairo, and convert, before the proposed meeting with Stalin. General Sir Alan Brooke, as the head of the British Army, was initially mystified by the Prime Minister's new directive. After all, the American president had recently made clear he would tolerate no postponement of Overlord. Aware from Field Marshal Sir John Dill, the British liaison to the US Chiefs of Staff, that in London the Prime Minister was plotting further adventures in the Mediterranean and Aegean, the President had summarily dismissed Churchill's plea that General Marshall be asked or ordered to attend a conference with Eisenhower and the British Air, Ground and Naval Commanders in North Africa, a conference that Churchill ominously wished to chair. Likewise, the President had seen no merit in the Prime Minister's cabled recommendation that the United States should provide American support, despite the recent failures in the Aegean, to a new British attempt to recapture Rhodes as the key to a new Mediterranean-Aegean-Balkan strategy. In a memo to Admiral Leahy, the President had rejected Churchill's latest petition in three simple words, to be dispatched to Churchill: Overlord is paramount. Later that same day, the President had sent Churchill a more explanatory personal cable, drafted by Leahy, which ran, "I'm opposed to any diversion, which will, in Eisenhower's opinion, jeopardize the security of his current situation in Italy, the build-up of which is extremely slow, considering the well-known characteristics of his opponent, who enjoys a marked superiority in ground troops and panzer divisions. In other words, focus on Italy, not Rhodes, while preparing for Overlord." To any normal person, the President's response would have closed the matter. Churchill, however, was no ordinary mortal. Unable to let go of his growing obsession with operations in the Mediterranean after the British fiasco in the Aegean, the Prime Minister had brushed aside the President's negative reply. "I am sure that the omission to take Rhodes at this stage, and the ignoring of the whole position in the eastern Mediterranean," he cabled back, "would constitute a cardinal error in strategy." "I am convinced," Churchill continued, in an attempt to explain such strong language, "that if we were around the table together, that this operation could be fitted into our plan, without detriment either to the advance in Italy, of which you know I have always been an advocate, or to the build-up of Overlord," an operation of which he was not an advocate, but which, he assured the President, "I am prepared faithfully to support." Faithful was not a word commonly attributed to Churchill. As a consummate politician, who had so often changed parties and allegiances, switching from the Liberal Party to the Conservatives, and from blind fealty to King Edward VIII to King George VI, after King Edward, ignoring his advice, had vacated the British throne to marry Mrs. Simpson. To buttress his argument for immediate Allied operations to retake Rhodes or hang on in the Dodecanese Islands, Churchill had poo-pooed any idea the Germans would continue to fight for southern Italy. The Allies now had some 15 divisions ashore, with 12 of them already in combat there, he pointed out to the President. Besides, he was convinced from ultra-decrypts of high-grade German signals, the German troops were not intending to offer serious resistance south of the Tuscan Mountains in the north of Italy, the top of the leg of Italy, to which they were supposedly ordered by the Führer to retreat if pressed. Churchill's own chiefs of staff had been as puzzled as the President by such obsession with the island of Rhodes. If the Germans withdrew to the north of Italy, all well and good, but what was the advantage in pursuing, in fact re-pursuing, operations in the eastern Mediterranean and Aegean? Why, above all, change the war's higher strategy to a new unplanned and unhinged campaign in the Balkans when Overlord, the cross-channel attack, was now barely 6 months away? How would a small island like Rhodes be critical when the Wehrmacht still occupied Crete, the largest of the Greek islands, on which the Luftwaffe had good airfields. Nevertheless, the Prime Minister, imagining himself a great strategist, had worked himself into a frenzy of excitement about the Rhodes attack, Brooke had noted in his diary. In fact, Churchill had magnified his importance so that he can no longer see anything else, and has set his heart on capturing this one island, even at the expense of endangering his relationship with the President, and also the whole future of the Italian campaign. As Brooke had confessed the next day in the diary he kept, both for his own sanity and for his wife to read, I can control him no more. Even Roosevelt's very cold reply, asking him not to influence operations in the Mediterranean, had met with no success, Brooke recorded. Churchill had merely wired back again, asking the President to reconsider the matter. The whole thing is sheer madness, Brooke had bemoaned, and Churchill is placing himself quite unnecessarily in a very false position. The Americans are already desperately suspicious of him, and this will make matters far worse. The realization that such a revision of Allied strategy would lead to yet another transatlantic battle between the British and American high commands had become more and more alarming to General Brooke. Over the next weeks, however, the Prime Minister's obsession had come closer still to insanity, or an inter-Allied passing of the ways. The Prime Minister's note to the British Chiefs of Staff on the evening of October 19, wishing to swing round the strategy back to the Mediterranean at the expense of the cross-channel operation, shocked Brooke. I am in many ways entirely with him, Brooke noted, given his own lack of faith in Overlord's chances of success and his wish to focus on dealing the Wehrmacht a major blow in Italy. But God knows where that may lead us to as regards clashes with the Americans. Yet Churchill was a master of creating great sagas over names he selected, such as Rhodes and Rome, and inflating dangers where it suited him. At the subsequent 10:30 p.m. War Cabinet meeting in London, a conclave to which Prime Minister Jan Smuts, visiting from South Africa, was also invited, Churchill had described a worsening military situation in Italy that he'd not forecast, but which now necessitated that the Allies put more of their eggs into the Mediterranean basket. This would, he claimed, mean making a decision not to switch battle-hardened troops to England, in preparation for Overlord as currently agreed, provisioned and planned, under the Quebec Agreement. Instead, by keeping such veteran forces in the Mediterranean, he would be in a position to throw seasoned British and American troops into further operations in the Aegean and the Balkans, with grand consequences if he could only get the Americans to agree. Where, though, was this secret new Churchillian strategy supposed to lead the Allies? The President and his American chiefs had wondered in Washington. Who in London was subjecting Churchill's opportunism to critical examination? Possessed by amazing bouts of energy, Churchill had seemed determined to make gold out of straw, with no one in London daring or willing to oppose his new strategy. I shudder at the thought of another meeting with the American chiefs of staff, even Brooke noted despairingly after the meeting on the 19th, and I wonder if I can face up to the strain of it. Yet he'd not dared contest the issue with his Prime Minister, instead confining his real thoughts to his diary. In this way, in the wake of his late-night meetings in London, Churchill had thrust himself into a new strategic campaign, giving rise to new excitement. Excitement that would allow him to marshal his considerable talents of persuasion and rhetoric in a renewed third major bid to switch Allied forces away from Overlord. Once effected, it would make the cross-channel gamble, shorn of battle-hardened troops, even less credible as an operation of war than before. Undeterred by the President's insistence on maintaining course, the Prime Minister had thus followed his cabinet meeting several days later by giving new notice to the President of the United States that he was definitely not happy with the Overlord plan, or timetable, agreed at Quebec. Our present plans for 1944 seem open to very grave defects, Churchill had cabled frankly on October 23, searching for fresh apocalyptic rhetoric that would awaken Mr. Roosevelt and his military advisers to the supposed disaster lying ahead in the Mediterranean, unless Overlord was put on the back burner. Adolf Hitler, lying in the centre of the best communications in the world, can concentrate at least 40 to 50 days against either Overlord or the Allies in Italy, Churchill had maintained in a long message, while holding the other front, the Eastern Front, from interfering. Churchill's own hopes of a quick advance to Rome, Pisa, and the Tuscan Mountains were meanwhile running into tough opposition, the Prime Minister now acknowledged, though he expressed neither responsibility for, nor shame at, having ignored the difficulties of fighting in the mountainous eastern Mediterranean, where island by island, Wehrmacht forces were methodically liquidating the surviving meagre British forces that had landed in the Aegean. It was the disastrous Battle of Crete, which the British had ignominiously lost in 1941, all over again. Yet the Prime Minister seemed oblivious to the lessons. Instead of questioning his aims and objectives in the Mediterranean theatre, Churchill simply used the dashing of his hopes as an argument for reviving them, this time with American arms and blood. The new situation threatened the Western Allies with stalemate in the war's strategy, Churchill now claimed to the President, unless they doubled down on their efforts, not only in Italy, but in the Aegean. He himself had coined the term soft underbelly for the Mediterranean, but it was a belly that was in fact far from flabby, he now argued, and would require much sharper harpoons. This left Overlord, in Churchill's mind, as a dangerous distraction, not the other way around. Allied commitment to Overlord, the cross-channel invasion was the problem, Churchill argued. Slavish deference to its timetable would hamstring the war in the Mediterranean, he claimed, and deprive the Allies of great prizes. And for this, he blamed the President's insistence on Overlord as the Allied number one priority, with its launch date of May 1, 1944, barely 6 months away. The disposition of our forces between the Italian and the Channel theatres has not been settled by strategic needs, but by the march of events, by shipping possibilities, and by arbitrary compromises between the British and Americans, the Prime Minister asserted, ignoring the agreed primacy of Overlord as the main plank in Allied strategy, and deliberately failing to acknowledge the fact that it was he himself who had forced compromises over the projected timetable. For at Quebec, he had personally insisted upon the addition of special lawyer-style escape clauses in writing to the agreement, namely to the effect that D-Day must be cancelled if the Germans brought more Wehrmacht divisions to France to oppose the landings than the current estimated number. Even the projected date, he now claimed, was a phony one. The date of Overlord itself was fixed by splitting the difference between the American and British view, he asserted, ridiculing the military staffs at Quebec, deliberately oblivious to the paramount need, expressed by the Overlord planning team, for a D-Day date as early as possible in 1944, to ensure sufficient summer weather for the subsequent long campaign in France. Overlord, in short, was a theoretical undertaking in Churchill's eyes, while the Mediterranean was real, a theatre that demanded more American and British forces if it was to be kept going or exploited. It is arguable that neither the forces building up in Italy nor those available for a May Overlord are strong enough for the task set them, he'd warned the President, urging him to put all Allied eggs in the Italian basket, not the cross-channel French one. The frankness, bordering on cheek, of this cable had been amazing to all who saw it on arrival at the map room of the White House. Yet Churchill's latest warning hadn't ended there. What he wanted, the Prime Minister pleaded in his cable, was that there be a halt to current D-Day preparations for Overlord. In fact, he wanted Mr. Roosevelt to order an immediate standstill in the move of all landing craft and American and British troops currently due to be transferred to Britain. Instead, the vessels and men could be put to better use, the Prime Minister urged the President, in combat in southern Italy, lest their absence cripple Mediterranean operations without the said craft influencing events elsewhere for many months. Landing craft? The President, for his part, had not been impressed by Churchill's rhetoric. He was even less impressed by the unstated objectives the Prime Minister had in mind for American landing craft. For what, exactly, were they to be used in the Mediterranean? Roosevelt had asked. Churchill's answer had been revealing. Rome. As a politician, Churchill had always been a dealer in symbols, and symbolism in wartime was certainly crucial, as Joseph Goebbels, Hitler's master propagandist, best knew. But why Rome, when the fascist Italian government and Italian forces had already surrendered to General Eisenhower in September? The little island of Rhodes had seemed to be a typical Churchill bee in the bonnet when the Prime Minister was haranguing his British chiefs of staff. Now, suddenly, it was Rome. All at once, seizing the Eternal City was a matter of highest priority, overriding preparations for D-Day and the timetable of Allied strategy settled at Quebec. Why exactly, the President wondered. The major port of Naples, after all, had been successfully cleared of German demolitions and was now safely in Allied hands, as were the great Foggia airfields. Rome itself was irrelevant, from a strictly military point of view, in fact, a red herring. Churchill certainly offered no military argument, yet insisted Italy's capital city now have priority in all Allied planning, operations and logistics. "We stand by what was agreed at Quebec," he maintained in his cable of October 23, "but we do not feel that such agreements should be interpreted rigidly and without review in the swiftly changing situations of war." The accusatory implication, namely that D-Day was hampering great opportunities in the Mediterranean, had led Churchill to his direst new prognostication. Unless the President of the United States were to make the Mediterranean and Aegean the immediate new priority of Allied strategic planning, the Prime Minister warned, there would be a disaster, namely that, if we make serious mistakes in the campaign of 1944, we might give Hitler the chance of a startling comeback. The argument for Churchill's alternative strategy in Italy sounded all too emotional, speculative, and suspicious. Logic had never been the Prime Minister's strongest suit, but there seemed to be a deeper motive behind his warning of disaster unless he got his way. British invasion forces on Rhodes had fallen to Wehrmacht forces in September, on Kos on October 4, and seemed likely to be captured or flee from Leros and Samos in November. To bolster his argument for focusing on Rome, however, Churchill had added a new plea, that surviving troops on Leros in the eastern Aegean should now be ordered not only to hold out at all costs, but be immediately reinforced by General Eisenhower's reserve American forces, including those slated for Overlord. There on Leros, they could form in the Aegean a great stepping stone to the Balkans, once Turkey was brought into the alliance. Suffering from influenza at the time, the President had been disturbed by the Prime Minister's telegraphic barrage. Churchill remained, in his eyes, a strange and wonderful individual, a creature of moods and passions, blessed with a gift for metaphor that had no equal in the world, a politician personifying great moral leadership in both the free world and in the occupied countries. Yet, what a calamity he was as leader of the forces of the British Empire. Almost every British military operation Churchill had mounted or touched in the war had failed, the President was aware, from Norway in the spring of 1940 to the Aegean in late 1943, where his folly was now approaching its inevitable end. Churchill had always been prone to switch from extremes of excitement to despair, the President knew. It was part and parcel of his character. His latest cables had been, Roosevelt thus judged, par for Winston's erratic course. Citing his flu, the President had thus continued to politely dismiss them and hold firm to the military strategy formally agreed at Quebec, Overlord, to be launched on or before May 1, 1944. Until, that is, the President had learned of Churchill's latest mischief in London and Moscow. Chapter 6. Churchill's Improper Act. At first, the president had been disbelieving. Was it really possible Winston Spencer Churchill would do such a thing? Yet the facts, when presented, were incontrovertible. Churchill had deliberately ordered that Stalin be shown part of a top-secret Allied military cable from General Eisenhower to the combined chiefs, without reference or permission from the president. Moreover, the Prime Minister had doctored the message to give the opposite meaning to the one intended. Of all the machinations Churchill had employed to sabotage Overlord throughout 1943, including his subversive appeals to congressional leaders on his visit to Washington in May that year, this was without question the most deplorable, the president felt. Clearly, having failed to make any headway in his communications with the president, the Prime Minister had decided to work directly on Stalin, behind the president's back. Roosevelt's supposition was, unfortunately, correct. Stalin, Churchill confided to his physician, Dr. Charles Wilson, seems obsessed by this bloody second front, and ought to be told bluntly that Overlord might have to be postponed, as the dutiful doctor had noted in his diary in London on October 24. The Prime Minister was digging in, willfully refusing to take into account how his objections to Overlord could upend the whole Allied alliance. "I will not allow the great and fruitful campaign in Italy to be cast away and end in a frightful disaster for the sake of crossing the Channel in May," he'd given his reasoning to his physician. It was on that obstinate basis, without telling the president, that he deliberately cabled to Anthony Eden, the British Foreign Secretary who was in Moscow at the Foreign Ministers' Conference, the attachment to Eisenhower's top-secret report to the combined chiefs, and had instructed Eden to show it personally to Marshal Stalin. The attachment was a copy of British General Sir Harold Alexander's latest pessimistic battlefield report from Italy, which General Eisenhower had appended to his message to the combined chiefs of staff. Churchill's cable to Eden, however, had deliberately omitted Eisenhower's commentary on the report, as Alexander's superior officer, in which Eisenhower had stated that he saw no reason for pessimism or alarm in Italy. Eisenhower had expressed himself, in fact, as very confident over the Allies' situation in southern Italy in his cable to the combined chiefs. As Allied commander-in-chief of all forces in the Mediterranean theatre, he had merely forwarded General Alexander's report as an attachment for their information in explaining why he disagreed with his subordinate. Far from believing Overlord should be postponed, Eisenhower felt the current battle in Italy was a perfect way of keeping the Wehrmacht locked in battle in southern Italy, unable to withdraw divisions from our front in time to oppose Overlord. If we can keep him on his heels until early spring, then the more divisions he uses in a counter-offensive against us, the better it will be for Overlord, and it then makes little difference what happens to us if Overlord is a success. In other words, General Eisenhower would welcome a German counterattack with the forces he had. There was no mention of a frightful disaster such as Churchill had warned the British cabinet to expect if current Allied strategy was not altered. Nor did Eisenhower see any need to halt the current move of landing craft to England, let alone the now battle-hardened combat troops and commanders being transferred for a successful Overlord in the spring. Que faire? News that the Prime Minister of Great Britain had, without telling the President, forwarded a secret, questionable British combat report to Marshal Stalin, with a message to be given to the Russian commander-in-chief that Overlord would, in all likelihood, have to be postponed as a result of the dire situation in Italy, was, in the view of the US Secretary of War, Henry Stimson, rank treachery. "Jerusalem, this made me angry," Stimson had expostulated in his diary after hearing of it on October 28. Stimson had fumed all day at the Pentagon. Thanks to Churchill's duplicity, which the Pentagon had heard about indirectly via General John R. Dean, head of the US military mission in Moscow, Stalin would not have the counter-comment of Eisenhower, Stimson bewailed in his diary, showing that he was not pessimistic at all. Fortunately, General Marshall had immediately, and on behalf of his fellow Joint Chiefs of Staff, sent a message to Dean in Moscow to make sure that Stalin and the Russian high command were told the actual truth. That General Eisenhower, the Allied commander-in-chief in the Mediterranean, was perfectly happy with the battlefield situation in Italy, and that Eisenhower and the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the United States did not think there was any purpose or reason to delay Overlord. It was perfectly ridiculous, Stimson noted in his diary. But this shows how determined Churchill is, with all his lip service, to stick a knife in the back of Overlord. And I feel more bitterly about it than I ever have before. British soldiers could be magnificent when well led, but their leaders are often, too often, manipulative cowards, Stimson felt. And Churchill, the worst of them, he rued. So upset was Stimson, in fact, that the next morning he'd gone to the White House without appointment to see the President's counselor, Harry Hopkins. The President's flu had made Roosevelt almost inaccessible. He has been sick 3 or 4 or 5 days, and now, when he'd come out of hibernation and was working again in the Oval Office, he had so much work on his desk that it is as difficult to get to him as it would be to get to Muhammad. Hopkins had been as concerned as Stimson when hearing of Churchill's new perfidy, however, and had insisted the War Secretary see the President in person. Stimson had thus been ushered into the Oval Office at 11:40 a.m., on October 29. There, he ascertained the President had already gotten word of Churchill's deceitful conduct. Stimson explained how General Marshall, on behalf of the combined chiefs, had already sent a riposte to be given by General Dean to the Soviet High Command in Moscow. To Stimson's relief, Roosevelt had been in complete accord with our views in respect to that, Stimson noted in his diary that night. In fact, the President intervened to tell me what his views were in regard to the Balkans. He said he wouldn't think of touching the Balkans unless the Russians found themselves struggling in southern Central Europe and asked for joint operations, which seemed unlikely. What the Russians needed was a second front that would force the Wehrmacht to fight both in the east and the west. Overlord, in the spring of 1944, was, and would remain, official and paramount American strategy for winning the war against Hitler. Stimson had been relieved. But if Churchill was willing to go behind the President's back in such a way, dirty baseball as Stimson termed it, what else might the British Prime Minister be capable of? Deeply concerned lest Churchill seek to sideline General Marshall once appointed to take command of Overlord in Northern Europe, where he would no longer be able to argue against Churchillian idiocies in the Aegean, Secretary Stimson and General Marshall had proposed a cable for the President to send to Churchill, saying he could not make Marshall available immediately to take command of Overlord. As their draft cable ran, the President should say to Churchill, "I am none the less anxious that preparations proceed on schedule, agreed at Quadrant," codename for the August 1943 Quebec Conference, with target date May 1, 1944. It was the British who should, immediately, appoint a Deputy Supreme Commander for Overlord, an officer who would receive the same measure of support as will eventually be accorded to Marshall, and could well carry the work forward. Namely, Field Marshal Dill, Air Marshal Portal, or General Alan Brooke. Though the President held off sending the signal, lest it exacerbate the quarrel, the unpleasant incident of Churchill's duplicity continued to rankle in the days after, a harbinger, Stimson worried, of further problems, now that planning for the war's end, the occupation of Germany, the defeat of Japan, and the post-war setup for international security was gathering pace. Stimson would never forgive Churchill for his Machiavellian machinations. For President Roosevelt, however, the Prime Minister's latest manoeuvre was, if anything, even more worrying. It was, after all, not Stimson who would have to deal directly with Stalin's probable reaction, which was not difficult to predict after 2 years of Allied failure to mount a promised second front. There had already been rumours of serious peace feelers between Nazi Germany and Russia in August and September, when it became clear to Stalin that the Western Allies might never mount a second front. Given that the Soviets were still struggling against three-quarters of the German Wehrmacht, Stalin would inevitably lose respect, not only for Britain, but for the United States and its word. How, then, would Roosevelt be able to negotiate from strength with the Russian dictator over the war's end, and over Soviet participation in the war against Japan? Also, over the establishment of a post-war system of security and a United Nations organization the president wanted Russia to join. Moreover, how would the American public, voters, press, institutions, and Jewish Americans especially, who were hearing more and more about Nazi extermination programs in Poland and Eastern Europe, react to the postponement or cancellation of Overlord? Would they not see it as a betrayal of their long, often reluctant support of a Germany first policy after Pearl Harbor, when the majority of Americans had wanted the president to focus first on defeating Japan? The president was as disappointed in Churchill as Stimson was, the war secretary found. The prime minister's deceit still rankling a week later, when he saw the president in the Oval Office, Roosevelt describing it as an improper act, akin to treachery. It posed a threat not only to Allied unity with the Red Army in defeating the Third Reich, but to Anglo-American unity and trust too, at the very moment when unity among the Allies would be vital in ensuring a peaceful transition to a post-war world. Strategic dissension between the primary Western Allies could only cause Stalin to see how divided were the US and British governments, and perhaps take advantage of it, just as the potential defeat of Nazi Germany approached. Would Stalin even agree to meet up with the president in the circumstances? Deciding it was best to pretend he did not know of Churchill's deviousness, the president had, in the end, merely continued explaining to the prime minister that he had not changed his mind over Overlord, and would tolerate no British backsliding on its timetable if it was to succeed. Moreover, to make extra sure Stalin had not been taken in by Churchill's recent ruse, the president had gone out of his way, before leaving for North Africa, to check with his trusted new ambassador to Moscow, Averill Harriman, cabling him to find out, preferably by return signal, what were the current strategic views of senior Russian military officials, including Stalin himself if possible. Harriman had done so, and the American ambassador had been crystal clear in his direct report to the president from Moscow on November 4, 1943. It is impossible to overestimate the importance they place strategically, Harriman had signaled. The cable received and decoded at the White House on November 6, on the initiation of the so-called Second Front next spring. Chapter 7. Torpedo. Such was the situation when the USS Iowa had left Hampton Roads. As his own first diary entry demonstrated, the president was hopeful, yet was bracing himself for an odyssey full of surprises. That the first one would come on day two of the voyage was on no one's radar, though. A lifelong mariner, the president had insisted he be shown each morning the daily navigation charts, marked with positions not only of nearby Allied vessels, but also of known or suspected U-boats. In addition to their latest snorkels, German U-boats sported new radar, he'd been told by Captain McRae, as well as an acoustic homing torpedo, the electric Zaunkönig, or Winter Wren, travelling at 25 knots, which could hit a target at 5,700 metres, or 3.5 miles. The Iowa was currently travelling at the same speed. By midday on November 14, 1943, the battleship and his escort destroyers were 533 miles across the Atlantic. Wanting his crew to be equally prepared for aerial attack once they approached North Africa and the Mediterranean, Captain McRae had arranged a demonstration of the battleship's armaments for the President and Joint Chiefs of Staff. As he later recalled, the weather was good, but there was also a brisk breeze blowing. The state of the sea was choppy, and a succession of whitecaps was evident on every hand. It had been arranged to exercise the Iowa's 40mm anti-aircraft batteries that afternoon at 1400 hours, so that the president and the distinguished passengers might see for themselves the the efficacy of this particular segment of the Iowa's anti-aircraft defense. The special presidential elevator made it easy for Mr. Roosevelt to go from one deck to another in his wheelchair and be wheeled across ramps built over the combings and deck obstructions. Thus, at 2 p.m., with the president's wheelchair held fast by Petty Officer Arthur Prettyman, his steward, the escorting destroyers were informed of Iowa's intentions and the drill got underway as scheduled. Weather balloons were inflated and released as targets, the ship's gunners having been ordered to deliver a veritable curtain of fire to stop enemy planes. The guns made such a deafening noise, the distinguished passengers had to stuff cotton wool in their ears, and for a while, the exercise went well. A number of the balloons were shot down. A creditable performance, General Hap Arnold, the Chief of Staff of the Army Air Forces, noted in his diary. It would be, Captain McCrae later thought, a nice surprise to those members of the Army Air Force who probably witnessed for the first time the partial capabilities of the ship's air defences. The drill had been in progress for, I should say, about 20 minutes, when, in an urgent tone of voice over the TBS, talk between ships, there was a somewhat panic-stricken cry of "Lion, Lion," Iowa's codename, "Torpedo headed your way." This from the USS William D. Porter, destroyer, which at that moment was about 45 degrees on our starboard bow, some 3,500 yards distant. It should be remarked at this point, McCrae later recalled, that during the anti-aircraft firing, Iowa was on a relatively steady course because the target balloons were going downwind. The William D. Porter was the center ship in the screen. On receipt of the torpedo warning, full speed was rung up. Battle stations was immediately sounded. The general alarm gong was clanging, the alarm bosuns used to prepare the crew to battle stations, followed by the statement, McCrae recorded that, "This is not, repeat not, a drill." Had there been a leak aboard this ship? McCrae remembered wondering. Had we been ambushed? All this took place in seconds, and then a bit later over the TBS from the Porter came the statement, "The torpedo may be ours." Remembering the incident with an embarrassment bordering on shame years later, McCrae allowed that the message had been some comfort to be sure, in that it meant they were not under enemy attack. This was not much help to the Iowa, however. There was still a torpedo heading our way, whether German or American. As ship's captain, McCrae now knew, at least, the probable direction from which the torpedo was coming, and that there would likely be but one underwater missile. I immediately altered the course of the ship to the right, to head for USS Porter. This in order to present as narrow a target as possible, he remembered, facing a torpedo that was, he judged from a professional naval officer's perspective, probably pretty well aimed. Would it hit, though? The ship had less than 6 minutes to respond. It was just as well McCrae switched course and headed toward the torpedo, for the Iowa was 888 feet in length, 12 feet shorter than three football fields laid end to end, as McCrae liked to say. The captain may have been pedantic in prose, but his swift, instinctive judgment certainly saved the USS Iowa from a calamity in the Atlantic Ocean. Below him, down on the first superstructure deck, President Roosevelt, Admiral Leahy, General Marshall, General Arnold, Harry Hopkins, General Watson, Admiral Brown, and Admiral McIntyre had gathered to watch the shooting, McCrae afterwards recalled. Their admiration soon changed to near panic. Harry Hopkins penned his own account that evening. In Hopkins' version, an officer from the bridge two decks above leaned over and yelled, "It's the real thing, it's the real thing." But the president initially didn't hear. The president doesn't hear well anyway, and with his ears stuffed with cotton, he had a hard time getting the officer's words. Words which I repeated to him several times before he understood. I asked him whether he wanted to go inside. He said, "No, where is it?" Suddenly, it seemed as if every gun was trying to hit the racing torpedo, not the barrage balloons, even though in the choppy ocean water, the torpedo could not clearly be seen, some 25 feet below the surface. More commands from everywhere. Whistles, flags, code signals. The din aboard the ship was terrific, General Arnold later wrote. Lieutenant William Rigdon, who was part of the President's map room signals staff, later described how President Roosevelt had been watching the gunnery exercise from one of the upper decks when he heard the warning. He called to Arthur Prettyman, his valet. "Arthur, Arthur, take me over to the starboard rail. I want to watch the torpedo." As Rigdon added, Prettyman, as he confessed later, was shaking all over, but he wheeled the President quickly to a vantage point. This was scarcely advisable, to say the least, but the President was the President and Commander-in-Chief. Given that the wind was considerable and white caps were everywhere, it was fortunate that at least the trace or wake of the torpedo was visible to us in Iowa, McCrae remembered. Just about the time we had really hit full speed, there was a tremendous explosion on our starboard quarter. The ship shuddered mildly, but sufficiently, to cause me to turn to Iowa's executive officer, Commodore Thomas J. Casey, and remark, "Tom, do you think we have been hit?" Others certainly thought so. Casey thought not, however, or the impact would have caused even more of a shudder, leaving McCrae, in later years, to ponder the reason. It is my belief that the turbulence caused by Iowa at full speed and executing a turn was sufficient to detonate the torpedo's firing mechanism, which resulted in its explosion. General Arnold, for his part, noted in his diary that night what a grand rest he'd been enjoying on the voyage, with not a worry in the world. Then the whole character of the manoeuvre and practice changed, once the alarm sounded and the ship suddenly swung to starboard. The wake of the torpedo became quite clear, barely 600 yards away. A depth charge went off. All the guns started shooting, 40mm, 20mm and 50 caliber weapons. As Arnold subsequently concluded, however, it was in vain, since nothing hit the torpedo. Whatever caused the torpedo to explode, the underwater missile hadn't actually hit the battleship, mercifully. Yet McCrae was not congratulated. About this time, when, of course, my attention was focused ahead, there was purred into my ear a low tone. "Captain McCrae, what is the interlude?" It was Admiral King, who had once told McCrae he was not enough of a son of a bitch to make a successful senior combat officer. McCrae explained the situation, upon which King, as US Navy Fleet Commander, rushed down and joined the President's party on the deck below to report. General Arnold thought the torpedo had missed the stern of the ship by barely 20 yards. As he noted in his diary that night, no hit, a miss, which caused 1,000 sighs of relief. They had almost literally dodged a bullet, and a big one. In everyone's mind, Arnold later wrote, was the question, suppose the torpedo had hit, and it had become necessary to take the President and all the high rank off the Iowa in those heavy seas. In a letter he intended to send his cousin, Daisy, once they reached Oran, the President thought it best not to mention the near miss. "I wish I could tell you about things each day," he apologized, "but I dare not." In the new diary his cousin had given him, by contrast, the President did record the ominous event for later reading. "On Monday last, at Gundrill," he penned, "our escorting destroyer fired a torpedo at us by mistake. We saw it and missed it by less than 1,000 feet. This laconic description left, however, a host of questions, and re-reading his entry several months later, back in Washington, Roosevelt dictated a note to be attached to the diary, which he intended to use in writing his memoirs, once the war was over. The destroyer in the escort was holding torpedo drill, using the Iowa as the spotting target. The firing charge was left in the tube, contrary to regulations. The torpedo was fired, and the aim was luckily bad. Admiral King was, of course, much upset, and will, I fear, take rather drastic disciplinary action. We fired the second battery to try to divert the torpedo. Finally, we saw it explode, a mile or two astern. Eventually, things calmed down, and further shooting was called off, McCrae recalled. By visual communication with USS Porter, to avoid the use of radio, it became clear it had been a torpedo all right, but not from a German submarine, as Hopkins put it. As General Arnold noted later that night, practice being over, everyone went back to normal duties and pursuits. It had been an accident, thankfully, not an assassination attempt. It must have come from some damned Republican, Hopkins quipped at dinner in the president's mess, attempting to make light of it. The mishap had been serious, though. As Lieutenant Rigdon later wrote, they had been more than fortunate. It had just missed being a day of tragedy. Chapter 8. A pretty serious set to. The president was not the only one heading to Tehran, and by sea. Prime Minister Churchill had left Plymouth on November 12, the same day as the president, aboard HMS Renown, a World War I battlecruiser. Tellingly, the Prime Minister was going without the current plans for Overlord. He was not interested in Overlord. Instead, General Brooke and his colleagues on the British Chiefs of Staff were taking with them only plans for the Anglo-American forces in Italy to advance to the Pisa-Rimini line in northern Italy, and for other operations in the Aegean if possible. These plans would, Churchill now insisted, necessitate delaying the D-Day assault by some 2 months at least, as Brooke noted in his diary. He was clear this would entail a pretty stiff contest with his US counterparts once they met up in Cairo en route to Tehran. Yet in certain ways, Brooke had come to welcome the impending clash. It would be a pretty serious set to, he acknowledged, one that would strain our relations with the Americans, but I am tired of seeing our strategy warped by their short-sightedness and their incompetency. The British chief's formal recommendations to the Prime Minister the previous day had thus stated that, in terms of Overlord, we do not attach vital importance to any particular date or to any particular number of divisions in the assault and follow-up, perhaps the least impressive admission of the entire war. The chiefs seemed to have no idea how important it would be to launch the assault in spring, to give the Allies a full summer to develop their campaign. British strategy should be, instead, to stretch the German forces to the utmost, in the hope that the Wehrmacht would crack somehow or somewhere. They were therefore firmly opposed to allowing this date to become our master, and to prevent us from taking full advantage of all opportunities that occur to us to follow what we believe to be the correct strategy. It was a lamentable performance. From his Wolf's Lair headquarters at Rustenburg in East Prussia, the Führer had also left on a trip. His was by armoured train, travelling to southern Germany, a visit designed to buck up German morale, now that the Third Reich had lost its primary partner, Italy. Given the menacing situation on the Eastern Front, where Russian forces had crossed the Dnieper and Wehrmacht forces were being forced to retreat farther and farther toward the Reich, Dr. Josef Goebbels, the Reich's minister for propaganda, had thought the Führer would have time to make such a political trip. Hitler, however, had his own ideas. On November 7, 1943, he therefore arrived in Munich in order to address the party faithful at the Löwenbräu Keller, where the Nazi Party had been founded 20 years before. His long speech, broadcast on German radio at 8:15 p.m. that night, had awed even Goebbels, who with the Führer's permission had edited it only lightly. Addressing himself both to his party comrades and Volksgenossen, or fellow citizens, the Führer had sounded amazingly confident and rational, indulging in his trademark sneering sarcasm, as well as his passionate belief in Germany's historic destiny in fighting Bolshevism and the Jews. What, he asked those present and those listening on their radios, would have become of Europe, and above all, our German Reich and our beloved homeland, had there not been the faith and the willingness of the party individual to risk everything for the movement? Germany would still be what it was at the time, the democratic and impotent state of Weimar origin. The Nazi Party had, the Führer claimed, saved Europe from world conquest by the forces of Bolshevism, a political movement he described as a Bolshevik Asian colossus, bent upon subjugating Europe until it is finally broken and defeated. The colossus was one impelled by Jewry, for the Jewish democracy of the West will sooner or later lead to Bolshevism, he predicted. The Jewish plutocratic West joining the Jewish Bolshevik East, crushing Germany between them. Instead of submitting to such a dark fate, however, the Nazi Party had successfully set about resisting it. While in the First World War, the German folk went to pieces at home, almost without enemy action, the Führer claimed, it will not lose the power of its resistance, even under the most difficult circumstances. And he warned, let nobody doubt this or delude himself. Only criminals could believe anything was to be gained by an Allied victory. Moreover, we will deal with these criminals, he snarled. What happened in 1918 will not repeat itself in Germany a second time. If tens of thousands of our best men, our dearest Volksgenossen, fall at the front, then we will not shrink from killing a few hundred criminals at home without much ado. If we catch one, he will lose his head. Rest assured, it is much more difficult for me to order a small operation at the front, in the realization that perhaps hundreds of thousands will fall, than to sign a sentence that will result in the execution of a few dozen rascals, criminals or gangsters. Allied attempts to bomb Germany into submission, he ridiculed, for despite the terrible suffering imposed on women and children, the damage done to our industry is largely insignificant. Within 2 or 3 years of the war's end, 2 or 3 million apartments would be constructed to house those made homeless by Allied bombing. Thus, while the Americans and English are right now planning the rebuilding of the world through a new United Nations agency, he mocked, I am right now planning the rebuilding of Germany. There will, however, be a difference. While the rebuilding of the world through the American and the English will not take place, the rebuilding of Germany through National Socialism will be carried out with precision and according to a plan. For this grand German reconstruction project, the Führer would bring, he explained, not only his vaunted Todt organization, the civil and military construction force headed by Fritz Todt, but war criminals roped in for the job. For the first time in their lives, the war criminals will do something useful, he stated, which thought led Hitler, in turn, to his next great threat, the preparation and use of Vergeltungswaffen, or weapons of revenge. The Allies would reap the whirlwind for having bombed German cities. Whether or not the gentlemen believe it, Hitler warned, the hour of retribution will come. And if we cannot reach America at the moment, there is one state that is within our reach, he declared, and we shall fasten onto it, using France as the launch pad for such weapons of mass destruction, aimed at England. Allied bombing, currently incurring terrible German civilian casualties, could only harden the determination of a typical German civilian, or Volksgenosse, to support the war fought to the bitter end, since only a victorious war can help him get his belongings back. And so the hundreds of thousands of the bombed out are the vanguard of revenge, Hitler declared. The enemy may hope to wear us out by heavy blood sacrifice. This time, however, the blood sacrifice will consist of 2, 3, or 4 enemy sacrifices for every German one. No matter how hard it is for us to bear these sacrifices, they simply oblige us to go further. Never again will it come to pass, as in the First World War, when we lost 2 million, and this loss was pointless in the end, that we will today pointlessly sacrifice even a single human being, for there would be no capitulation, only victory, he predicted. Germany will never capitulate. Never will we repeat the mistake of 1918, namely to lay down our arms at 11:45. You can rest assured of this. The very last party to lay down its arms will be Germany, and this at 11:05. In conclusion, the Führer said, he wanted to add one more thing. Every week, I read at least 3 or 4 times that I have either suffered a nervous breakdown or I have dismissed my friend Goering, and Goering has gone to Sweden, or again Goering has dismissed me, or the Wehrmacht has dismissed the party, or the party has, by contrast, dismissed the Wehrmacht. And then again, the generals have revolted against me. And then again, I have arrested the generals and have had them locked up. You can rest assured everything is possible, he allowed, but that I lose my nerve is completely out of the question. With this display of black humour, the Führer had signed off. He gave thanks to the Almighty who had blessed Germany and had allowed it to take this fight successfully far beyond the borders of the Reich, rather than to have to fight it on German soil. Moreover, had helped it to overcome nearly hopeless positions, such as the Italian collapse. He therefore asked the party faithful to leave the beer hall with fanatical confidence and fanatical faith that would guarantee Nazi victory and the domination of Europe. We fight for this. Many have already fallen for this, and many will still have to make the same sacrifice. The blood we spill will one day bring rich rewards for our folk. Millions of human beings will be granted an existence in new homes, to be built by slave labour, supplied by the Tote organisation, and war criminals, Sieg Heil. Goebbels was delighted, noting in his diary what a propaganda triumph the speech had been, and what a media defeat for the Allies it would be, especially in the neutral countries. Even the rate of suicide went down in Germany, he noted afterwards. Hitler had confided to him that in the coming 2 weeks, he was hoping for great things on the Eastern Front, where German counter-offensive moves were being prepared. Despite their own propaganda boasts, after all, the Russians had been unable to retake the Crimea. Goebbels was of a mind to believe his supreme leader. After all, German civilian morale was recovering. The British had been trounced in the Aegean and were being held back in southern Italy. In London, Churchill was having to warn Parliament of darker, longer days ahead than he'd once predicted. The recent conference of foreign ministers in Moscow, in which preliminary discussions had been held as to how Germany should be carved up and its industry and manpower distributed to the victors, suddenly looked childishly premature. There is only one way for our enemies to win total victory in this war, Goebbels summarised in his diary on November 14, 1943, unaware that President Roosevelt was at sea, halfway across the Atlantic, to insist on this very point. And that is a successful Allied invasion of the West. Chapter 9. Marshall, Commander-in-Chief against Germany. 3 days out at sea, at 2 p.m. on November 15, 1943, the President summoned his Joint Chiefs of Staff to a formal meeting in his cabin, where they could discuss a paper he'd asked them to draw up to counter the British plea for a new, alternative Allied military strategy in the Mediterranean and Aegean. At the meeting, the US chiefs voiced their adamant opposition to any departure from Overlord and its timetable. The President said, as far as he was concerned, "Amen," the minutes of the meeting duly recorded. How to bring the British back into line, though? Whitewashed by generations of subsequent historians, this was the great tragedy of the war in late 1943, that, at a moment when Hitler and Goebbels had no real idea how they could win the war in Europe, beyond stoicism and the use of Vergeltungswaffen, and recognised the only way they could lose the war was if the Allies launched a second front, the Allied coalition faced the danger of being split apart by Winston Churchill and the British. Churchill's obsession with the Mediterranean and the Aegean, of course, was nothing new. His Dardanelles operation in World War I had resulted, after all, in a fiasco, entailing terrible loss of life, and his own resignation as First Sea Lord, or Minister responsible for the Royal Navy. Therefore, he'd insisted upon serving as a battalion commander on the Western Front. This battlefield service had only reinforced his opposition to trench warfare, however, and, ironically, fueled his belief in the use of tanks, the very weapon the Wehrmacht had used in 1940 to smash its way across France, backed by modern tactical air support, yet which Churchill declined to believe the Allies could employ in northern France in 1944, targeting Berlin. Dreading the inevitable casualties the amphibious invasion would entail, and the subsequent land battle if the Allies even managed to get ashore, Churchill had continued to hope British forces could avoid having to face the main armies of the Wehrmacht in the west. Thus, where the President had seen North Africa and the Mediterranean as a proving ground for US military leadership, inter-service cooperation and combat effectiveness in the run-up to the mounting of a successful cross-channel invasion, Churchill had drawn the opposite lesson. The complete defeat of the British Expeditionary Force in the retreat of Dunkirk in May 1940, and then the fiasco of the Dieppe raid in August 1942, had sapped his confidence in British Empire troops and their commanders. For him, the Mediterranean was not only a crucial lifeline of colonial empire, but also a means to use traditional British sea power to surround German-occupied Europe, not attack it, save with bombers. In this way, the Soviets would, if possible, be tasked with defeating Hitler, leaving Britain still intact at the heart of a colonial empire that could be reconstructed after the end of hostilities. The agreement over Overlord, timed to take place on or before May 1, 1944, had, in his mind, never been more than a piece of lawyer's paper, as he'd put it, a contract which Britain could simply decline to observe, or could keep asking to defer each moment the bill came due. That moment, however, was now coming, and in travelling with this small army of advisers and clerks aboard HMS Renown toward the Middle East, the Prime Minister began to recognise the enormity of what he was proposing, namely a complete recasting of Allied war strategy, barely 6 months before the agreed launch date of Overlord. Afterwards, Churchill would drag his literary coat over the British revolt. His subsequent history of the war, completely concealing the way in which he had behaved in London in October 1943, as he plotted with his chiefs of staff to subvert the Quebec agreements made only 2 months earlier. One of the most blatant pieces of distortion in his 6 volumes of memoirs, as the distinguished Cambridge historian David Reynolds would write. Having effective command of all British Imperial forces in 1943 as Prime Minister and Minister of Defence, Churchill had in September of that year begun a maverick campaign over the Dodecanese. Then, when this had turned to disaster, he had come close to throwing Overlord overboard, while subsequently hiding his egregious strategic machinations in a willfully inaccurate account. Composing his war memoirs, Reynolds recounted, Churchill had been persuaded by his writing team to suppress the incriminating key pieces of evidence against him. The secret instruction to his chiefs of staff on October 19 to plan an alternative strategy to the one agreed at Quebec. The duplicitous cable to Eden to explain the need to delay Overlord, and his negative subsequent memo to his chiefs while travelling to Cairo. Moreover, the team had wanted him also to delete his draft explanation for his alternative strategy, namely that his own scheme was to bring Turkey into the war by dominating the Aegean Islands, and thereafter enter the Black Sea with a British fleet, and aid the Russians in all their recovery of its northern coast, the Crimea, etc., as well as debouchements near the mouth of the Danube. No British or American army was to be employed in this. Naval and air forces might have sufficed, as Churchill's draft chapter had it. As Reynolds commented, sending a British fleet into the Black Sea was hardly a minor operation, and it sounded a little too close for comfort to Gallipoli in 1915 to be included in the published book. Fortunately, it was removed. The historical truth remained, however, concealed from the public and later historians, who did not have access to the documents Churchill had purloined from 10 Downing Street when unseated as Prime Minister in 1945. Namely that, in the fall of 1943, Winston Churchill had vowed to do everything in his power in London to sabotage Overlord, at the risk of splitting the Allied alliance. What Reynolds left unexamined was the further question, why? What could possibly explain Churchill's willingness to risk the transatlantic partnership? In fact, the whole Allied coalition against Hitler. Had he, as the British Army Chief of Staff Sir Alan Brooke put it in his diary, simply gone mad? Scratching their heads, historians would never quite make sense of Churchill's fierce determination to get his own way, even to the point of threatening to resign as Prime Minister on October 29, 1943, as he did following the War Cabinet meeting that night. Certainly, like everyone involved in Overlord, Churchill felt a genuine concern at the casualties the D-Day invasion would entail, yet such an explanation did not really hold water, since operations in the Mediterranean, judging by recent Allied experience in southern Italy and the Dodecanese Islands, would hardly involve fewer casualties, were they to be mounted as the major Allied campaign of 1944, opposed, undoubtedly, by do-or-die Wehrmacht forces, and for no strategic purpose except one. If the aim of the Allies was to defeat Nazi Germany, prolonging the British Empire. Besides, the fear of cross-channel casualties, as the Prime Minister's doctor noted, had never held back Churchill from undertaking an operation that he himself wished to tackle. Gallipoli alone had caused more than 160,000 British Empire casualties, as well as almost 30,000 French. What then, in retrospect, could really explain Churchill's scheming and machinations, as Professor Reynolds described them, at such a juncture in the war? It was, after all, the third time that year he was proposing to ditch the agreed Allied strategy, a Peter-like denial, despite having twice formally signed up for a spring 1944 priority for Overlord. What magic, moreover, had Churchill managed to employ to persuade his entire British Chiefs of Staff to follow him down this hole, in direct opposition to the President? And how had the Prime Minister gotten the entire British War Cabinet to support him in his latest October crusade, and his dire predictions of disaster if they didn't? Was it solely Churchill's fabled way with words and his stature as Prime Minister, or was there some other explanation? Certainly the US President and his advisers, meeting together aboard the USS Iowa, seemed unable to understand Churchill's mounting obstructionism toward Overlord in the run-up to Tehran. What was the Prime Minister playing at? Given that the United States had rescued Britain from defeat in 1942 and had deliberately bloodied its own forces in the Mediterranean in 1943 in preparation of troops and commanders for Overlord, the latest British rebellion was galling. Why were they doing it, and how could they be stopped? It was this question the President put to his advisers in his cabin on November 15, 1943, aware that, at the end of the day, there was no actual way to enforce the Quebec Agreement if Churchill resigned or withdrew British commitment to military participation in the May 1944 cross-channel undertaking. The war against Hitler would, effectively, be lost, as it might equally be lost, too, if the President accepted Churchill's alternative and the Soviets decided to negotiate with Hitler rather than suffer more casualties in assuming the main burden of combat against the Wehrmacht. The US military was thus between a rock and a hard place, with no obvious way of breaking the impasse. By suggesting that a Russian observer might attend the combined Chiefs of Staff meetings in Cairo prior to Tehran, the President had first hoped, he told his chiefs, the British could perhaps be shamed in front of Stalin's representative. This tactic had failed, however, the President explained in his cabin, and not only because Prime Minister Churchill was emphatically against the Russian observer proposal, Stalin too had wrecked the plan, if inadvertently. For once the Soviet Premier heard that Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek would also be present in Cairo, he didn't dare send a senior Soviet official. The Soviet Union was still not at war with Japan, and had no wish to give the Japanese a pretext for declaring war on the Soviet Union, which would in turn force Stalin to withdraw Russian forces from the Eastern Front. There was, therefore, probably no alternative, the president felt, but to stonewall once the American team reached Cairo. They would have to try to defer any serious strategic debate over Overlord to the big conference in Tehran, where the United States and Russia could together shoot down the British Fantasia, even though this would mean facing Stalin, thanks to British intransigence, with a weakened and divided Western Allied hand. After much discussion, this game plan then was decided upon. Regrettably, it was the only way for the Americans to proceed, the president made clear. The chiefs would have to ensure, in drawing up an agenda for the preliminary meeting in Cairo, that the meeting with the Chinese Generalissimo and himself and the Joint Chiefs of Staff was to be separate from and precede any meeting with the British, i.e., leaving as little time as possible for the British to raise their expected objections to the Quebec Agreement before leaving for Tehran. The only other alternative the chiefs could suggest was a kind of preemptive move, to put on the Cairo conference agenda a renewed insistence that the yet-to-be-appointed Supreme Commander of Overlord, an American, should be made Supreme Commander of both Overlord and the Mediterranean, and thus be able to quash any operations in the Mediterranean that might delay Overlord. It was, in the context of this two-part stratagem, namely to stonewall any discussion of changes to Overlord's timetable, while asking the British to agree in Cairo to the merging of both the Second Front and Mediterranean operations under one American commander, if necessary, to achieve this objective, that the president finally went on record as stating for the first time in an official meeting that the Supreme Commander of Overlord would be General George Catlett Marshall. As the minutes of the meeting recorded, it was the president's idea that General Marshall should be the commander-in-chief against Germany, a role in which, in Europe, he would command all the British, French, Italian, and US troops involved in this effort, the defeat of the Third Reich. Chapter 10. A Witch's Brew. Aboard HMS Renown, Winston Churchill was dead set against any such merger of the two theatres, the idea of which he'd learned just before he left England. The Prime Minister was suffering from a heavy cold, and his mood had darkened aboard the grey British battleship as it made its way south toward the Mediterranean. It didn't help that, on November 15, weather conditions at Gibraltar precluded him from switching to a plane for the onward journey to Malta. Harold Macmillan, the British political advisor to General Eisenhower, thus visited Churchill in his cabin early on November 16, 1943, to witness a fascinating performance by the Prime Minister, the greater part of which was a rehearsal of what he is to say at the military conference, and he is terribly worried and excited about this. It would be, Churchill explained at Gibraltar, a grand Anglo-American showdown. Far from seeing the Mediterranean as a holding pattern by the Allies, while full-scale preparations were made for the spring cross-channel assault, Churchill was openly caustic about the Allies' failure to be more offensive and flexible in southern Europe, a failure he attributed not only to the combined Chiefs of Staff system, but to our American allies generally. The Americans, he told Macmillan, had all along restrained his military genius, causing the Prime Minister to feel that all through the war he is fighting like a man with his hands tied behind his back, and this when he was, ironically, the only man alive who could have enticed the Americans into the European war at all, wooing President Roosevelt, as he once put it, as a man might woo a maid. The approaching sextant meeting in Cairo prior to Tehran was thus, in Churchill's mind, critical to the course of World War II. It would be, Churchill predicted, the war's real turning point, as the effete debonair Macmillan recorded Churchill's words in his diary that night, and the hardest job he, Churchill, has encountered. The Prime Minister's way with words, of course, was both a mark of his genius and a curse. Macmillan sided with the Prime Minister. Macmillan had been severely wounded on the Western Front, at Loos in 1915, and again in 1916 at the Battle of the Somme. offensive campaigns that had devastated the British Army for no tactical or strategic gain. Like Churchill, Macmillan had been scarred for life by this experience of trench warfare. He'd studied Greek and Latin at Oxford rather than French or German, and his role as current British political diplomat advisor to General Eisenhower, ever since the torch invasion of Morocco and Algeria, he'd felt deeply at home in the Mediterranean. He was happy where he was, and hated the very idea of overlord and a vast Allied campaign in northern France, which might require his transfer to northern Europe. He was, in short, the very last person to point out to the Prime Minister the folly of what he was proposing. The irony, moreover, was that Macmillan, like Churchill, was half American, his mother having come from Indiana. And given his daily meetings with General Eisenhower, the seasoned diplomat ought to have foreseen the likely American response to the Prime Minister's obsession with the Mediterranean, aimed at Rome. Macmillan found himself too entranced, however, by the brilliance of Churchill's rhetoric to caution him, recording with delight instead how Churchill derided his military advisor's pusillanimity. Men crushed, Churchill claimed, by the British Chiefs of Staff system that brought together air, army, and navy strategists. It leads to weak and faltering decisions, or rather, indecisions. The Prime Minister scoffed at their concerns over his Mediterranean plans. Why, you may take the most gallant sailor, the most intrepid airman, or the most audacious soldier, put them at a table together. What do you get? The sum total of their fears. This was a Churchillian bon mot of a very high order, spoken with frightful sibilant emphasis, as the political adviser noted in his diary, thinking of the hissing, spitting sound the Prime Minister made when delivering such ex-cathedra judgments. Yet it was dangerous talk, with potentially dangerous consequences. Like Churchill, Harold Macmillan was a bon vivant and something of an English social and intellectual snob, which also played a part in the gathering saga. Despite his New World heritage, Macmillan saw American officers as being, for the most part, brash and often ill-educated in comparison with his own classical Eton and Oxford education, and, to be sure, most were. Like other Englishmen, he thus forgotten the sorry failures of British military forces in Norway, France, Greece, Crete, Libya, and Egypt, and had begun to feel not gratitude for the way the United States had helped save Britain in 1942 by mounting the torch invasion, but instead a discernible resentment at growing American economic and military might in the Mediterranean. He thus failed to see that, by encouraging Churchill to defy the President and oppose the formally agreed Quebec strategy, the Prime Minister might thereby drive the President of the United States to make nice with Stalin in order to put down Churchill's insurrection, with huge potential political as well as military consequences for the Western Allies. Would it have helped if Macmillan had been instructed to report to Eden, the British Foreign Minister, rather than directly to Churchill? It is doubtful. The British Foreign Secretary was even more culpable than Macmillan in his failure to challenge the Prime Minister's recalcitrance. Anthony Eden knew, in person, how much the Soviets were counting on a spring 44 invasion to help defeat Hitler, yet had not dared to bring the Prime Minister to his senses. Instead, he had simply passed on the Prime Minister's deceitful cable to Stalin, dutifully telling Stalin that the British would do our very best for Overlord, but it is no use planning for defeat in the field in order to give temporary political satisfaction. The Second Front, a temporary political satisfaction? Churchill had instructed Eden to tell the Russian Premier that all previous assurances given to Stalin about May Overlord in 1944 would now be modified by the exigencies of the battle in Italy. Nothing, the Prime Minister had cabled, would alter my determination not to throw away the battle in Italy at this juncture. Eisenhower and Alexander must have what they need to win the battle, no matter what effect is produced on subsequent operations. This may certainly affect the date of Overlord. Eden had loyally conveyed this warning to the Russian Marshal. I again emphasized, the Foreign Secretary afterwards reported back to Churchill, your anxiety that Stalin should have the latest account of the situation in Italy. Unaware Churchill had deliberately deceived both Eden and Stalin by forwarding General Alexander's battlefield report without Eisenhower's accompanying contrary assessment. As Eden had summarized his audience with the Russian dictator, he told Stalin he should know not only that you were anxious about it, but also that you were insistent that battle in Italy had to be nourished and fought out to victory, whatever implications on Overlord. His cable sent to Churchill, the very night the Prime Minister was threatening his cabinet colleagues he would resign if he did not get his way over the strategic switch to the Mediterranean, Aegean, and Balkans. It was small wonder Marshal Stalin had been unimpressed. Eden's assertion that, in view of the vitally important decisions now confronting the Allies, it was all the more necessary that the three heads of government should meet as soon as possible, had met with Stalin's disbelief. After looking quizzically at Alexander's top-secret negative account of operations in Italy, Stalin observed with a smile that if there was not sufficient divisions in Italy, then a meeting with the heads of government could not create them. Eden had reported Stalin's response word for word to Churchill, as well as Stalin's remark that it was not for the world's leaders to furnish troops, but for the British and American chiefs of staff to do that. He then asked point blank whether the Alexander telegram, which he had just read, meant a postponement of Overlord. For his part, Anthony Eden had been deeply embarrassed and could only quote Churchill's message to him that there was no use.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.